So the reason why we decided to have this event on Gandhiji and living, education and family. Basically, we haven't found a right top title for this event, but still we'll be covering Gandhiji's views on basically education and also family values and also maybe on gender also, gender equality, all those issues we'll be handling. The idea of this initiative, this event came after Mr. S. N. Sahu wrote an article for us related to the farm bill. He likened, I mean, connected it to the Champaran struggle, which took place in 1917, and which was a major revolt at that point of time. And he also started the freedom struggle from that event, from Bihar. So that is how we thought of having a discussion, because we are soon to have the 150th birth anniversary to be celebrated on October 2nd. So to begin with, I was also wondering, because most of us at school level also, we study about Gandhiji, maybe some anecdotes or chapters taken from the his autobiography, My Experiments with Truth. And of course, some stories which might have been taken from Navajivan or any of the Harijan. But there is a large volume of literature related to Gandhi and his teachings. And so I was also yesterday going through one book, which is actually a collection of speeches. You can see. So Inside Mahatma's Mind. So it's a collection of speeches and writings that has come from. So much of information which I haven't heard about. Maybe we haven't studied also all those things. So there is a wealth of the knowledge and insights that we still have to gain from Gandhiji's teachings, and also his thoughts, which he has shared across different platforms. So we had shared some ideas with Mr. S. N. Sahu on this, and I think we can start off basically with the family environment, because and one of the two important ideals, he always said that he had nothing new to teach the world. Truth and ahimsa are as old as the mountains. But I found from this book that he had learned about the lesson of nonviolence from his wife. So when he tried to bend her to, I mean, when I tried to bend her to my will, and she was resisting my will, and that's how my effort to bring her to submission failed. And so that is how this concept of what you call ahimsa or satyagraha, non-violence, that was ingrained in him at South Africa itself. So I would like to begin off with how much relevant, actually, Mr. Sahu has also written an article for us for the October issue, which is about how Gandhi's ideals are relevant in the COVID times. So right now, this is the 150th anniversary. So I would like to begin off with a general statement about what Mr. David Thomas looks at this whole, his body of teachings, and how much of it is now relevant to the present modern contemporary India.
Good evening. And would you like to me to focus on education and family, or in general about Gandhian relevance today?
We'll start off with that, and then we'll move into education and family values.
In general, I think the more the problems in the world increase, the more we see the relevance of what Gandhi tried to tell us. The amazing thing is that Gandhi was able to see all this back in 1909 when he wrote Hind Swaraj, which is perhaps his most important work. And even at that time, he was able to see the direction the world was going in. And most of the problems we face today have, in a sense, been anticipated by Gandhi. So his relevance is perhaps even more today than it was in his own time. Today we see acutely, for example, how mankind has denuded the world of all its resources. And Gandhi saw this in 1909 and said that this is the direction in which mankind is taking the world. Today we see how true that is, and how he used this phrase to describe what the world would be like if Indians began to consume resources the way Americans did. And he said that we would strip the world bare like a swarm of locusts. And Indians have still not started consuming as much as the Americans have, but the Chinese have started consuming a lot. And so we're beginning to see the effect on the environment of everybody trying to live a life modeled on the West. People have now adopted the American lifestyle, American goals, as the kind of model to aspire for. And Gandhi saw in 1909 that this would be unsustainable. And we're seeing that today. Similarly, Gandhi also had this idea that the world and our view of the world should not be anthropomorphic. We shouldn't focus on human beings alone. The world belongs to a lot of other species also, and nature. And Gandhi, of course, saw this from a religious viewpoint. He felt that the whole world is one. The whole world is God's creation. And so we should not be so anthropomorphic. And we're seeing that today, that because we have completely, taken over all the resources of the world, that even other species, like animals, for example, we don't hesitate to kill wildlife. We have uncontrolled dairy farming. We kill pigs, cows, sheep, and the cruelty involved in that whole meat industry is phenomenal. But we think it's okay because we think that it is sanctioned by the mankind is the axle around which the world rotates. But that is not true. And Gandhi was able to see this at that time and to tell us that, no, you should not do this. So that's another thing I think which we can learn from Gandhi. And of course, we can learn from Gandhi about being able to see the whole of mankind as one. And there's that lovely phrase by Mahadev Desai in which he says that Gandhi once told him that a good human being is one who is able to see another human being's pain. So it could be the pain of a black person in the US. It could be the pain of a struggling South American in Guatemala. It could be the pain of ordinary women and children trying to live in Afghanistan. It could be the pain of anybody. But we should be able to see that whole pain. And that is what human beings, the human experience is all about. That again is something we can learn from Gandhi, that we should be able to see other people's pain, because then we will stop trying to add to that amount of pain. Gandhi also said that, again, because he believed that all humankind was one, he believed that you should have that basic intuitive sympathy for other human beings. And of course, there's a lot that we can say about this and examples from his own life about unity. But that, I think, is also one of his signal contributions to discussions. Then, of course, was his contribution to truth. Today, there is so much of untruth everywhere in the world. The Washington Post fact checker recently came out with a thing about Trump and said that in the last 1,027 days, Trump had made, 20,000 false or misleading claims. In 1,000 days, 20,000 misleading claims. And Trump is not alone. There are so many world leaders who make absurd, completely wrong, false, factually false statements. So, and Gandhi had this thing about truth, that we must all have a a kind of fanatic adherence to truth. And to quote the words of Reginald Reynolds, which my friend Sahu knows about, you know, Gandhi used to say, Reginald used to say this about Gandhi, that he had a scorching passion for truth. Today, who can you point to any leader in the world who has a scorching passion for truth? I would find it difficult to find any such person. So this whole thing about being true, being honest, not exaggerating, speaking the truth, living the truth, is something which, again, I think we can learn from Gandhi. Another thing I think about Gandhi, which we can learn and which is underestimated and underreported, is the fact that Gandhi was half a communist. Gandhi really wanted a society in which there was virtual equality, or at least that the disparity should be greatly reduced. And he made so many statements in support of that. He used to say that to the poor, God can only appear in the form of bread and no other way. And even in terms of agriculture, he used to say that the peasants should own the land. His whole focus was on reducing disparities. And he used to tell the zamindars that if you don't treat your peasants better, they will come and take away your land. And Gandhi seemed to approve of those actions. And of course, his letter to the viceroy saying that, you know, your income is 5,000 times that of an ordinary Indian, that is intolerable. Today, the disparity is even much worse. So inequality, and that we need to do something to reduce inequality in the world, that is another thing which I think we can learn from Gandhi. There are many other points about Gandhi, but I think I'll come to that later. I shouldn't do all the talking.
Yeah. So very important points made by Mr. David, especially about the untruth, because truth was one of the most important pillars of Gandhi's philosophy and principles. So also you talked about other inequality and other areas. We also need to look at the policy making angle, whether all these have an impact on people who are making the policies or laws, legislators, and how that in turn will influence the whole nation. Because our freedom struggle was got mainly because of the leadership of Gandhiji. And even when you repeatedly go through his writings or even his speeches that he has delivered, you know the kind of involvement that has come from him into each process, whether it is communal relations, a lot of things, and how Congress has to conduct itself. So to begin with, that children gives us a lot of hope, whatever be. But at the same time, we should be concerned, as you have rightly pointed out, that so many untruths are spreading. They are watching all these things. So I would like to have Mr. Sahu's view on how, what is the message that we can give to our children, and especially about Gandhiji's writings. And you have mentioned about the book Pal Poti, and whether that has been implemented, or how best we can have that textbook as a core part of our curriculum. And what is the way forward for us?
Actually, what David said, regarding his very sensitive, observations on truth in the present day context, and juxtaposing that with Gandhi's pursuit of truth. Truth is God. I think this needs to be presented to the children at school level, at college level. Because children have the impression, at every, be it school, college, or university, where is truth? Everybody is speaking lie. Be it at the level of the leadership, or be it at any level. But, this notion, that truth should be the guiding force. For instance, the data concerning COVID death, a number of infections. Every country, every state in India, every country in the world, actually there is no truthful statement coming. From many countries, except maybe Germany or South Korea or Vietnam. So therefore, truth not just as a spiritual pursuit or as a philosophical pursuit, how truth or truthful approach is relevant even to formulate public policy and to address the problems that we confront. Unless we have a truthful exposition of the problems, nothing can be done. Nobody can actually address those problems effectively. So therefore, we need to contextualize it by citing the challenges that we face, to plan, to take measures in the absence of proper data. So therefore, truth is required even at the level of the public policy. The data is fudged, they say. Data is fudged because by the political regimes. Our unemployment data was not released, and so many other figures and statistics, they are not presented truthfully. As a result, the public opinion on those issues are not being formed to the extent it should have been. This is one point, but in particular in the context of education, let me cite a few points for our discussion and also for transmission to children at every level. See, for instance, Champaran Satyagraha, was the first Satyagraha of Gandhi in India. The Champaran Satyagraha had a educational dimension because Gandhi saw in Champaran that there was no school. Children had no access to education. So he established a school, and that school still is existing in Champaran. And the people who came to teach there, they were all from Maharashtra. So he mentions the names of those ladies in his My Experiments with Truth. But apart from establishing an institution, it still continues. What he wrote about education in the context of Champaran Satyagraha, that is a very critical significance now for 21st century India and world as a whole. For instance, he talked about education through interactive mode, not just through books, not just through rote learning, but through interaction. So education must be transmitted or imparted through a process of interaction and a joyful method. And he clearly wrote that corporate punishment or punishment for children should completely eschew, completely stop. See, now this is an issue which we find as part of the education policy. Now teachers are being punished in case they beat students in schools, or they try to punish them, in a manner which was being done earlier. And Gandhi prescribed that in 1917, education through interaction and complete, end to the punishment, the corporal punishment. That's what he said. So today teachers are really scared of punishing children in schools. And there are many instances where teachers are held accountable if they are punished for punishing the students. So this is very important. I mean, as early as 1917, he talked of imparting education through interactive mode. I mean, this education policy, one may have so many disagreements with it. And in fact, a lot of problem areas are there in the present new education policy. At least it talks about that kind of interactive mode, and it also prescribes that we need to put an end to this rote learning and all that. So this one particular point which has to be kept in mind, education through interactive process, and without punishment to the children. And it should be made more joyful. The other point, in fact, I wrote an article after a district in Odisha, Ganjam district, which is the southern part of Odisha, in March, I think first week of March, there was a decision taken by the government that in the government schools, every Saturday would be a bagless day for children up to primary six. It was done on an experimental basis. That on Saturday, every Saturday, children would come without textbooks or without school bags. And they would devote time in the school for other activities, maybe painting, maybe music, maybe some other activity. So, and that was widely reported in the media. And it would be very instructive to note that. I wrote an article, I'll send you the link. In 1937, in an article, Mahatma Gandhi wrote that, there are heavy school bags which students carry to schools. Textbooks were becoming very heavy for them at that tender age, to carry them to school and also to read them or pursue studies. So in 37, he talked about reducing the burden of the school books, school bag and textbooks. Now just imagine 10 years before independence, Gandhi had that vision. And today, it is being prescribed, talked about, and then this new education policy. It actually is, has a provision. They said that there should be 10 days on which, the students should not carry bags to the school. You might have read the education policy.
Yeah.
So it is there in the education policy, the present education policy, about which I am very, very critical. Okay? So this aspect needs to be talked about among the parents, teachers, public policy, experts. School bag fee day. 10 days should be devoted for that, as per the present education, the recommendations of the National Education Policy 2020. So we need to, I have written a piece, I didn't forward it to you. I'll send it to you, that how it was done on an experimental basis in Odisha. It was started in March. Okay, and this has been now recommended by the National Education Policy. Plus, besides, the great writer, R.K. Narayan, the writer of the Malgudi Days, a well-known, celebrated writer. Yeah. He made a special mention in Rajya Sabha in 1980s. He said that school bags must be, made less heavy, but it should be made lighter, because our children are carrying a huge load to the school, and the number of books are quite high or heavy. And therefore, 1980s it was demanded. And so we need to put them together and circulate, disseminate for wider discussion, so that public opinion is mobilized in its favor. Through your web portal, through your magazines, through our discourses, whenever you get an opportunity, we need to talk about that. So the first is interactive mode of, communication with the students, and minus corporal punishment, and then lessening the burden of the school bags, and so on and so forth. This was raised by Gandhi. We need to underline that particular point, flag that point. The other point is that, Mahatma Gandhi talked about music education. you know, from 1926 onwards, when he went to Gandharva Music School in Gujarat, he delivered a speech which is worth recalling and analyzing. He said, you know, he defined music. I mean, in several of his, you know, writings, he referred to music, and he said, what is music? He said, music means rhythm, harmony, and order. Because nobody enjoys music if it is just, you know, crude sound. There has to be some rag, there has to be some rhythm, you know, be it light music or classical music. Okay, so he said, rhythm, harmony, and order, if, you know, is at the heart of music. And he said, because music education was never part of the school curriculum or college curriculum or university curriculum. So he said there was no order in public life of India. And he said, India would never get independence without music. So we know that Gandhi linked independence to Hindu-Muslim unity, to women's upliftment, to sanitation, you know, economic equality, abolition of untouchability, you know, to several other spheres. You know, he said Swaraj, he defined from such broad terms, without Hindu-Muslim unity or sanitation or, you know, abolition of untouchability, even eradication of leprosy and so on and so forth. But he also said that without music, India would not be able to get Swaraj. And music, he meant rhythm, harmony, and order. So music education, you know, is sadly lacking, you know, in our school curriculum. So this has to be emphasized. I mean, we are so rich in terms of our musical tradition. And we have Karnataka, Hindustani now. There is a demand from Odisha that Odissi music should be treated or recognized as a classical form of music. You know, they are tracing it to, you know, very ancient period, I mean, some BC. You know, so such demands are there, and they are very rich in terms of music. And so Gandhi's emphasis on music education, that there should be music education right from school, and he said it should be made compulsory. And so in the UK, there is a national policy for music education. It was introduced, I think, 2017 or something. Okay, so there was an editorial in London Guardian that the policy has been framed, but nothing, not much has been done to take it forward. So therefore, this is another point which has to be there, you know, in our discourse or discussion on education. So Gandhi, you know, when he was in South Africa, he referred to education in madrasas, which is very, you know, quite stunning that he also reflected that the education that was being imparted in madrasas, there is a purely religious in nature, the secular components should also be there. Okay, now this is quite stunning that, you know, he talked about secular education in madrasas apart from religious education. And that is true as much for madrasas as for any other, you know, institution of education, be it madrasa or many other institutions which have come up. And of course, secular education is there. So, I mean, now CBSE curriculum is quite, enforced across the country. This is one aspect. I mean, he was so sensitive to even reflect on Madras education and, you know, and that issue of education imparted in madrasas, that is becoming, you know, that is being used as a communal, you know, a strategy for, you know, targeting minorities, you know, in UP, in Bengal, in, you know, a large part of Hindi heartland at least. But I don't think in Kerala, Tamil Nadu, it's not the case. So this is another point which needs to be reflected and needs to popularize by talking at different forums. So, and of course, his Baal Pothi, you know, is very important because I think, you know, he's, I think, one of the foremost leaders of humanity who talked about gender equality at home. You know, 1922, he, you know, that Baal means children, Pothi means book. So he wrote a textbook for small children, and it is called a primer. In the collected works, it's available as a primer. And when I was serving, you know, working in Rashtrapati Bhavan with President K.R. Narayanan, so First Lady was invited to speak at the United Nations office in Delhi on International Women's Day. So I had read that Baal Pothi. There is a small chapter called Housework. So there is an imaginary debate in the family, you know, imaginary fight rather, the family among brother and sister. Sister wanted to study and play like the brother. He was following her brother. Brother said, "My dear sister, you are a girl. You should not do what I am doing. You should follow mother, who is cooking, washing utensils, looking after home." Then sister said, "Why shouldn't I follow you? You are playing, you are going out, you are studying, and she should also do that." Fighting, then mother intervened. Mother said, "No, my dear son, you are wrong. House is for both, for everybody." So that Baal Pothi is meant for school children. And unfortunately, that Baal Pothi has not been introduced in the educational curricula or at the school level, in spite of the fact that after First Lady Mrs. Usha Narayanan, used that in her speech, and Professor Madhu Dandavate wrote a letter to Education Minister that time, HRD Minister Murali Manohar Joshi, to translate Baal Pothi to all languages of the states of India and introduce in school curriculum for character building and education of children. So I think you can take an initiative, you know, Sri Kumarji in Kerala.
Yes.
Because you are working in this sector, and all of us should talk about it in the present, context of the COVID, where, you know, women, they are, subjected to more domestic violence because of this lockdown, shutdown, they are confined to home. And today I was reading an article of the New York Times, you know, how women have been thrown back, you know, to 10 years, 10 years back in history because of the situation that is prevailing, you know, due to COVID pandemic. They are subjected to more domestic violence. They are burdened with more household work. So this book of Gandhi, you know, should be introduced. In fact, in Japan, in school education, this idea of sharing of household work has already been incorporated. In Mexico, women are demanding that the idea that household education should be, you know, part of both men and should also be performed by men. You know, they have been demanding every year to the government. And, I was reading an article where I think in Spain now boys are being taught in school how to cook food. Yeah. And they are being, taught that it is their responsibility to do household work. And so it's very quite fascinating that what is being done now or demanded now, you know, Gandhi, you know, thought about it. And his book, Baal Pothi, had many other small chapters, very tiny chapters. Early morning prayer, then work in the field, and exercise. Exercise is also there. So children today, we have so much of child obesity.
Yeah.
Where you know, we need to address that by you know, introducing Balpati. So I think these are the few points which you need to be borne in mind, and these are the points which are I mean, which I got myself educated when I found all these points in Gandhiji's original writings. Mm-hmm. Apart from basic education, apart from what you call Nai Talim, these are the things which are so deeply relevant, you know, for our time, when we talk so much about, you know, enriching the value-based education, gender equality, and so on and so forth. So these are the few points which I thought. So
yeah, definitely. Those are very, very, very valid points that you have said. But I would like to just quickly go back to Mr. David Thomas, because now the important point is that raised by both of you is that Gandhi had a lot of values or ideals that we still can cherish and maybe we can still implement. But somehow the same concepts which he had told many, many years ago, even before independence, that is still not being implemented. Now it is again put in the education policy. So wherever you look, whether it is in environment, in public policy making, or in public discourse, whether it's related to families, we find that a lot of his ideals are still not implemented. So why is it that we are still far away from the Gandhian ideals, and how can that be brought back to our lives? I think that is a very important point we should be thinking at this 150th anniversary. Of how to bring back Gandhi into our lives, to be part of our everyday.
I think the unfortunate thing is that even when Gandhi was alive, and even during the freedom struggle, most Indians did not really understand everything that Gandhi was trying to tell them. And they did not take into their own hearts his values, his policies, in everything. The only thing they understood was that he's trying to lead them to freedom, that he's trying to throw out the British. And for that, they supported him. They also thought that he was a Mahatma, that he was a great man, that he was a person who renounced everything. So they were willing to go with him and to back him fully. But even at that time, if you were to ask people, what are Gandhi's policies in different areas? I don't think anybody, even the people in his own Congress, even those Congress ministers who became ministers after 1937 and 46 elections, most of them had no idea what Gandhism really stood for. So I think as a country as a whole, we have not really, either at that time or now, taken into ourselves Gandhi's basic teachings. We have just backed him to get us freedom from the British. His closest confidants like Jawaharlal Nehru had his own set of beliefs about society, about industry, about everything. And similarly, Sardar Patel had his own set of beliefs. So when after Gandhi left, there was no one really to take forward his beliefs, his core beliefs. The people who were left were people like Vinoba Bhave, people like Jayaprakash Narayan, and the economist Jay Kumarappa. And none of them were in positions of power. So India as a state moved away from Gandhism completely. And people just said, yes, he was a great man. He got us freedom. Even today in the villages, if you go and ask people who Gandhi is, they will tell you that he's the father of the nation. But beyond that, no one knows anything about his policies. So it's not at all surprising that today no one really follows his policies. So if we want to, again, bring back Gandhi, we have to, you know, it has to be a really strong campaign. And I think the government, whether Congress or BJP or anybody, is not likely to take forward Gandhi's views on education or economy or society. So I think there is a need for civil society, for NGOs, for people who are working in education like you. I think this is where education comes in, that that an attempt should be made to tell ordinary people what did Gandhi really stand for. And we should leverage the great capital that Gandhi has. Because even today, across the country, the one person which everybody will say, yes, he was a great man, is Gandhi. But so we have that capital to start with. But beyond that, we need to associate specific, what did Gandhi say about education? What did he say about unity? What did he say about the way we should treat women? And so a huge campaign is needed. I'm not sure if it will succeed. I'm not sure if it's too late really to bring in such a campaign. But I hope someone takes it up.
Great. So I will get back to Mr. Sahu, because we are again back to the educational part of it. How best we can make the policymakers to implement some of the ideals that he lived for, and how to get that message across to children. Because we now, as Mr. David has already said, that we still are far away from his ideals. We have not brought him into our lives. We have such a very huge treasure lying with us, but we are not able to utilize that and then use it for the progress of the nation. So beyond that celebration of a Gandhi Jayanti, or telling children that, okay, he is the father of the nation, we have not actually gone into the heart of his teachings. Or so how best, since it can happen only from a bottoms to top approach, can we do it that with the children itself?
Yeah, I think David is absolutely right, because Gandhi, you know, was considered as a cult figure, a figure which, and an impossible figure, I mean, which, you know, humanity never witnessed, or India's history, or in human history or Indian history. You know, I remember Sardar Patel having said that now that we have got freedom from British rule, I think, you know, he said, I don't know how he said that, he said, you know, Gandhi's approach may not be relevant. It is the statement of Sardar Patel. He said he was an outstanding leader. But Sardar Patel went to the extent of calling that he is the father of the world, not just father of the nation. But then his approach, the kind of problems we confronted after partition of India. So he said, that approach of Gandhiji, you know, is not suited, was not suited. The biggest problem is that, you know, even in JNU, when you were studying, you know, David studied ancient Indian history, I studied political science, and we had, you know, courses on you know, freedom movement. I mean, in the syllabus, we studied the freedom movement. There was marginal, you know, coverage given to Mahatma Gandhi. Okay, so, and we never studied Gandhi at the graduation level. You know, so the pedagogy was never developed. Now, for instance, let's talk about nonviolence. Nonviolence was understood as non-application of force, okay, to pursue the objectives in life. So nonviolence, when it is reduced to only non-application of force or weapons or arms or let's say a kind of approach which is muscular, you know, Gandhi said that's a very limited meaning of nonviolence. In fact, in 1937, he wrote a beautiful essay, you know, the sum and substance of which was nonviolent mass action. Okay, so now then he said, what is nonviolence? And he defined nonviolence from very wider terms. He said nonviolence would mean sharpening of the mind. Nonviolence would mean to accept effect is effect. What is truth? As David said, you know, the idea of truth is so relevant in present context. So he said, if you accept a fact, you know, that's a form of nonviolence. If we sharpen our mind, or intellect, that's a form of nonviolence. Now, in several colleges and schools, whenever I got an opportunity to share some ideas on Gandhi, so I used to tell the students that, you see, all of you are here in this school or college or in university, and by studying, in sitting in library or discussing with your friends or classing with them through ideas, you are following Gandhi. Because he said, Gandhi said, sharpening of intellect is a form of nonviolence. So when you are in class, when you are debating, when you are in elocution competition, or when you are, engaged in arguments with your friends, this is nothing but, you are literally following Gandhi. Because he said sharpening of mind is a form of nonviolence. So you need not, wear a khadi, you need not wear, take non-vegetarian food. You eat whatever you want to eat as per your choice. You wear whatever dress you want to wear. But if you sharpen your mind, you are following the path of Gandhi. The students were quite fascinated to look at nonviolence from this perspective. So I said, all of you are following Gandhi by joining the university, by studying, by arguing, by debating. That is the students, that is what the students do wherever they are, or wherever the family level and social level, people do argue. Amartya Sen said, argumentative Indian. So what is argumentative Indian? So that if you reduce it to nonviolence, this means, sharpening of mind. Unless one has a sharp mind, some ideas, so how does one argue? So therefore, we need to explain these things, through our writings, through our, the opportunities that we get to share ideas. See, for instance, Gandhi said that, what is nonviolence? Nonviolence means to accept a fact. And however bitter or sweet that fact may be, you just cannot dismiss it. So, see, for instance, during this Black Lives Matter, which got intensified in America and in several other parts of Europe, many statues were pulled down. Those statues which represented the association of those persons in history, when they were involved in slave trade or some such things. So they were all pulled out. Gandhi wanted that the statues of those British soldiers who were responsible for repression of the sepoys or people during First War of Independence, this should be removed. He demanded removal of those statues. Then many others wrote to Gandhi. He said, your demand for removal of statues would promote ill will between Indians and the Britishers, and how can promotion of ill will would be compatible with nonviolence? Because through nonviolence you want goodwill, but by removal of statues you are promoting ill will. He said those statues represented violence, repression on Indians, and that was a fact of history. Now you need to accept that fact. And when you accept that fact, you are accepting the core principles of nonviolence. So it might lead to promotion of ill will, but the fact that you are accepting a fact, that itself showed very clearly that we are adhering to the core principles of nonviolence. Now, this kind of interpretation of nonviolence, which are available in the writings of Gandhi, they have never been talked about. For instance, Gandhi said in the Nonviolent Mass Action, that article which he wrote, he said he gave 18 or 20 points. He said removal of illiteracy is a form of nonviolence. So nonviolent mass action is required to remove illiteracy. Now all that, the Ernakulam model in Kerala, you know, which was adopted in the rest of the country to remove illiteracy or promote literacy, you know, or what was done by Kerala Sastra Sahitya Parishad, you know, to promote science, scientific temper, education, and removal of superstition. Ah, Gandhi also said, even removal of superstition is a form of nonviolence. Okay, now, so, and then he said even reformation of judiciary, so that people would get quick and inexpensive justice, is part of nonviolent mass action. So what is happening in Supreme Court today? You know, people are being, Prashant Bhushan was charged with contempt for a tweet. You know, then, so much time is taken to adjudicate a matter. So these are all forms of violence. So Gandhi said reformation of judiciary for providing quick and inexpensive justice is a form of nonviolence, part of nonviolent mass action. Social enfranchisement of women is a form of nonviolence. Now, this is, you know, the management. Spearhead women across the world. You know, now we, you know, now gender equality, women's can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. So you know, this entire movement to interrogate patriarchy, to challenge patriarchy. You know, so this is, you know, Gandhi wrote long years back. You know, Gandhi said that, see, we talk of greater representation of women in legislatures. As early as 1931, he said, if the future legislature of India would not have more women in its fold, you would boycott that legislature. Now, these are the points which were mentioned in President Narayanan's, K.R. Narayanan's speech. Because they were taken from the collected works of Gandhiji. But when in Rajya Sabha, Women's Reservation Bill was taken up for discussion, you know, none from Congress, neither did they quote Gandhi or Nehru. Even Nehru wrote about greater representation of women in Parliament. Now, so these are the, you know, wealth of literature which is at our disposal. But nothing is done, you know, to unearth those ideas and put them suitably in curriculum or develop a pedagogy. It's never done. So therefore, I think time has come when, you know, these forces which believe in, you know, denigrating the values of freedom struggle, you know, they need to be countered by such ideas. And you know, it has not been done. It must be done on a priority basis. And at our level, you know, when I wrote this article on Bal Pothi, you know, many people say, you know, I went to Maharashtra to a village in Konkan. You know, there I was invited to speak on Gandhi, and when I referred to Bal Pothi, you know, one lady teacher from a village school, very simple lady, Renu Dandekar, she came to me. He said, how do I get Bal Pothi? I want to translate that to Marathi. So I had a copy because it's only 5-7 pages. So I told her, I gave her, and she has been writing about it, talking about it, and she has a school in a village where Lokmanya Tilak was born. In that village, there was no school 25 years back. You know, so you know, it's very exciting to go to those places in Maharashtra and to see how, you know, Renu Dandekar and her husband Raja Dandekar, that's remarkable. They constitute a remarkable couple. You know, they are so fascinated, you know, by the ideas of Gandhiji. So they immediately seized the opportunity and took Bal Pothi, and they have introduced in that school. They talk about Bal Pothi. So we need to reach out to several schools like that, and you know, even David has an NGO, Bharat Nirman Sangh, and there he's doing remarkable work by transmitting values of Gandhi to village women. You know, he's organizing meetings twice a week. So this can be done actually. So this is how we need to go ahead.
So another important slogan that we hear Gandhiji, which we often read about or hear about, is the Swadeshi, boycott of foreign goods. In 1991, we had to take the liberalization route, and now we are inviting more and more foreign investment in the country. And of course, there is on the other hand, the Skill India, Make in India, and other things are there. But if you look at the period after independence, people were never really proud of owning a Made in India brand. People preferred a Made in Japan or Made in USA or Made in China. And even now, we find that even the last 5 or 10 years, you can find a surfeit of Chinese goods coming into the country. We were dependent so much on China. And once this COVID broke out, now we have banned so many Chinese apps and products from the country. So the Gandhiji's core teaching of being proud of India's own products, and that Swadeshi, building our own products and feeling proud of it, shouldn't we bring that back in us? Because that is a strength that the nation has, rather than being too much dependent on foreign goods. How much of that thing? Even as he said that we should be open, our mind should be open to other cultures. So let them freely come and let the wind blow. But we should not be blown by those winds. That let's win those cultures. Let it come and go, but we should not be blown off by those cultures, but we should be inherently be Indian. So how to go about that kind of a pride that we always had at the time of freedom struggle? I think Mr. David should be able to throw some light on that.
I'll try, although I don't know too much about Swadeshi. But, you know, Gandhi was did not only talk about Swadeshi, but he also talked about going even more local to the level of the village. And Gandhi's slogan always was to produce locally and sell locally. So not just at the level of a country should we be sort of self-sufficient. Gandhi wanted that in each village we should be self-sufficient. Within the village itself, we should produce everything we need in that village. And we should develop the crafts which are particular to that village and use that and sell that locally. And that is, I think, increasingly becoming an excellent economic principle, which I think the world will be forced to adopt. Even in this COVID time, for example, during the lockdown period, you found that once again in each little town, each little village, there was a resurgence of, to some extent, local craft, because that was the only thing. You couldn't get anything from outside, so you had to use what is available locally. So Gandhi meant that in the sense that be as local as you can. And Swadeshi at the national level is just one example of being local. It's even better to be local at the village level, if not at least at the country level. So Gandhi on one level wanted to be as local as possible. At the other level, he wanted to be as international as possible. He always said that my nationalism is a specific example of my internationalism. And he was very particular that finally his loyalty was for the entire human race. But he wanted to begin with his nation, which was India. So that dilemma of how much to be international, how much to be local, has continued up to this day. I think Indians, like people anywhere in the world, when we have a product which is good, we definitely prefer the Indian product to a foreign product. It is just the unfortunate thing that in most areas we don't have products which are comparable to foreign products. That is why we tend to buy an iPhone rather than to buy an Indian phone or to use various things. We all like to buy foreign goods. But almost anybody in the world, I think, has that love of their own country, or more specifically, the love of their own state or their own town. If, for example, I'm living in Kodaikanal and there are some very good wood products which are made in Kodaikanal, I will definitely prefer to buy it. And I am doing that. It's only when you don't get that you tend to look elsewhere. And also this whole thing of advertising, it distorts everything. Gandhi saw the dangers of advertising in his time itself. He said, I dislike advertisements because they are so untrue. Today, we see the same thing. The advertisements are untrue and they make us buy things. They make us have this kind of fascination for goods which are not our own. So we have to fight against that tendency. And advertising is, again, going back to the issue of truth. One great example of untruth, which we accept. And I don't know why we accept it. To give just one simple ad, you look at an ad for a Maruti car. It doesn't sell a Maruti car, it sells a lifestyle. You think that you'll automatically have a family like the family which is shown in that ad. Now, these are absolutely untrue associations. But the government and society allows these untrue associations to be created. So we want to buy those kinds of products and it distorts everything. So I think Swadeshi is a good idea. I think more than Swadeshi, going absolutely local is a very good idea. But we must balance that with the realization that we are part of the human race.
Okay. Would you like to describe your activities very briefly? As Mr. Sahu had said, you are working with women in the village level, empowering. Could you just brief it and how relevant it is to the Gandhian ideals that we were talking about?
Well, basically from 2004, we started this organization, which is called India Nirman Sangh. And we've been working among the poorer people, particularly women, in the hills around Kodaikanal. And we like to think that we're doing it with a basic Gandhian approach. So one of the main activities we do is forming small self-help groups, getting them loans from banks, helping them to start small businesses. To some extent, it is like Kudumbashri in Kerala, yeah. And in many other places in the north, you have these Mahila Mandrams and so on. So that is one basic activity which you're doing. And there, what we're trying to do, which is Gandhian, is to improve the living standards of the very poor people. And that is a very Gandhian thing to do. The other thing is that we are encouraging the idea of working cooperatively. Instead of doing this individually, you work as a group. And as a group, you start a small business, which again is a Gandhian ideal to work along with others. The other thing we also do is we have a Gandhi center here where we run small courses on Gandhi, not intellectual courses, but we run these courses for ordinary women from villages, where we try and tell people what Gandhi is. We go beyond just saying that Gandhi is the father of the nation. We encourage women to think about their own lives. When we talk about truth, for example, we just try and tell them that, try and ask them, are you true today? Or do you tell lies, for example? And then, it's so sad that today, when I run these classes for women from villages, almost nobody says that, yes, it is possible to be honest today. Most of them simply say, I'll give answers like, we should try and be as honest as possible, but it's not possible to be totally honest. Or they also say that sometimes you have to tell lies in this society. Or sometimes they say that, in Tamil, they say, alava poi chulnu, which means you must tell lies, but not too big lies. So this is the state of our society. So we try and talk about Gandhi and what he means by truth and non-violence and working for the poorer people. So we run these classes at our Gandhi center here. Now, another activity we've started for the last 3 years is to work among farmers. And again, Gandhi always felt that farmers and farming should be encouraged, and because finally India lives in the villages. And so we are trying to improve cultivation methods for the vegetables which are grown in this area. This is basically carrots, beans, potatoes, garlic, things like that. And that is a big area of our activity which we're doing now.
So great. It's very heartening to know that you are involved in so many activities at the grassroots level, which even though you are not telling them theoretically, when they are doing that, they are becoming part of the Gandhian culture. And you are also taking an effort to teach them in a very simple manner without much pedagogical tools what Gandhi stood for. That's a great message that you have for the nation. But I would like to quickly again, before we try to make a conclusion, because Gandhiism cannot be confined to a very 1 hour kind of a discussion. It's a very vast topic, I understand, and I also only know a very a small part of it, and this is a learning exercise for me. What I thought was the cooperative movement that Mr. David Thomas now said about, that cooperative societies, that is also, I think, a Gandhian kind of principle or ideal that he always had. When we look at the dairy system in India, we have the dairy cooperatives now. So right now the farming bill, it tries to bring in lot of even foreign investment and some kind of contract farming, which is totally opposed to the Gandhian ideals, which may be more suited to the the cooperatives kind of societies, developing cooperative societies and then involving all the farmers, which Mr. David was also talking about. So what is your view on the, you also wrote about the farming bill, which two bills that were passed now. So are we totally going out of track in this regard? What is your view?
I'll just try to add a few points about the Swadeshi, which David so nicely explained. You know, how during this COVID period, these local products, they assumed relevance. And that's what Gandhi said, that local resources must be used. So I'll slightly, add a few points. I mean, based on my understanding of, what Gandhi wrote about Swadeshi movement. See, in 1905, when he was in South Africa, he wrote in Indian Opinion that Swadeshi movement, which was started in Bengal, to protest the, protest against the protest, this partition of Bengal in 1905, seems a pale imitation of Chinese method of boycotting foreign goods. So it was an education for me to know that Swadeshi movement itself is not the original idea of Indians. So we borrowed it from China. And Chinese, boycotted American goods, during that time, before 1905. And Gandhi said that it's a pale imitation. Swadeshi movement was a pale imitation of Chinese method of boycotting American goods. Okay, so, so in the context of the Chinese products, we can say that it's not an original idea, we borrowed it from China. So this is one point which has to be kept in mind, this is a historically correct perspective. The other point, Gandhi once used a term called Swadeshi economy. He said Swadeshi economy is that economy which is based on the use of indigenous resources available in 10-15 kilometers of radius. Okay, so then when a session of the Indian National Congress was organized in Ramgarh in a village, Nandlal Bose came with his paintings, and everything was organized within 10-15 kilometers. Food, vegetables, other material. Then he said, if resources available in 10-15 kilometers should be used, that would actually promote the local economy. that would empower people who produce those goods or those agricultural products. So, and there was a, there was an article which I read in Times of India, where it was stated that there is a zero energy based housing society in London. And the residents of that housing society, who are obviously not environmentalists or people, not the protagonists of environmental causes, they were all professionals. In the entrance of the zero energy based housing society, it was written that if an average citizen of the planet Earth uses as much energy and resources used by average citizen of Britain, then world would require 5 planets. So they said we need to use resources which are available in 10 to 50 kilometers of radius. Now they said by using resources or energy available in 10, 15 kilometers radius, they said we'll reduce food miles. Food miles means the number of kilometers or miles that are covered to bring food from distances, whatever distances. So they say that if you take food from 1,000 kilometers, then per unit of food or material, some energy would be required for transportation. And if it's a perishable good, some energy would be required for refrigeration. And once the food reaches the destination, some energy would be required to take it to the departmental store or to the consumer's door. So he said, but if you use resources for food available in 10, 15 kilometers, so relatively much less energy would be required. So therefore, they calculated that food that is taken from long distances and used by people, so correspondingly more toxic fumes are released because you use fuel or electricity for transportation, preservation, and so on and so forth. So they talked of reduction of food mile by using resources available in 10-15 kilometers. Now, without knowing that Gandhi wrote about Swadeshi economy in terms of 10-15 kilometers radius within which we try to get resources. So the Swadeshi economy is so relevant even from the point of view of environmental preservation, and ecological security, which is now threatened globally, and the result of which is alarming levels of global warming and climate change. So this is one aspect which is refreshingly, corresponding to what Gandhi envisioned during freedom. But he never said that we should not use things which are not from abroad, which are not available in India. So that way he was not a narrow nationalist or a narrow protagonist of Swadeshi. Okay, so this is one point which needs to be kept in mind. Other thing is that, that you said about this farm bills, which were taken up in Rajya Sabha and passed through voice board, and I wrote about it. In fact, there is a fear. I mean, I haven't studied the provisions of those bills. But there is a fear that this contract farming, which is one of the provisions in the bill, one bill, that would allow, there would be a contract among farmers and the fellow who is going to cultivate that land. Now, in that contract, how many farmers have the ability to understand the contract, a legal contract? There was a time even there's no lawyers in India to understand the legal contract between India and the other country. So we used to hire lawyers from different countries to understand a contract. And luckily after the establishment of national law school universities, we are no more dependent on these foreign lawyers. Now you just imagine a small farmer signing a contract with a corporate sector or a businessman, even a small businessman. Lawyers will write something. They will ask the farmer to sign. And then based on that contract, if businessman or the corporate fellow will have access to that farmer's land. And he will, as per the contract, he will get some produce, the farmer. Now, the finer provisions in between the lines in that contract may not be at all intelligible to the farmer. So eventually the businessman will say, okay, fine, after 5 years, as per the provisions of the contract, I am the owner of your land. So I believe we are going back to the pre-Champaran race. I have a solid fear that during pre-Champaran Satyagraha, the corporates were forcing farmers, British planters, forcing farmers to plant indigo in the best possible land, fertile land. And they were forced to do it. It was going on for centuries. Now, similarly now, there will be big corporates or maybe even business people who will sign a contract that will be beyond the understanding of the farmer. And eventually the farmer will be forced to cultivate that land as per the dictations of the... So there is a fear. And P. Sainath, he very nicely explained that, these APMCs, they are like government schools. Now no well-off parent or even a reasonably, good family, they know never send their children to government schools. But through this evolution of APMCs, eventually, the government school, which is now only accessible to the children of the poor families or children of the SCST families, backward families, backward in terms of social factor and economic factor, that will be finished. So he said, if you abolish government school, saying that teachers don't come, we have just one or two teachers, they are busy in imparting education, cooking food for midday meal, so education has become a casualty, so let's close down government schools because they are not at all serving the purpose for which they were established. Now this means completely wiping out the opportunity for the poor fellow to even enter a school. So I believe there is some kind of a replay of pre-Champaran days. Gandhi's fought for the farmers, and that first Satyagraha, which began with the breaking of law by Gandhi. And then it was taken forward through engagement, consultation, then deliberation with the farmers, with the corporate planters, British planters, colonial bureaucracy, police. Then Champaran Agrarian Bill was framed. So Champaran Satyagraha, which began with breaking of law by Gandhi, ended with framing of law. And these laws have been framed without any deliberation, consultation, or even these bills were not even subjected to the vote in Rajya Sabha. They were so hurriedly, passed on a voice vote. So I believe when this contract farming is coming up and the possibility of APMC is getting closed, so I think there is some kind of replay of history of colonial period. Unfortunately, even in India, when we are celebrating 150th anniversary birthday of Gandhi, so we are going back to the pre-Champaran days. This is my fear, frankly speaking.
Okay. So this discussion is almost going for 2 hours now. So many issues have been discussed. I am very happy that so many things have emerged from this both of you. I'm sure that this is a very big ocean. We have only tapped a very small part of it. But and by coincidence, we are having the farmer struggle in the one, as you rightly pointed out, in the 150th anniversary, and we are back to the Chambaran days of 1917. So looking ahead, what is the hope that as we as what you call lovers of Gandhi or who hold the Gandhian ideals, what is the hope that we have for the coming years? Very briefly, I would like both of you to have your view on that, because ultimately we have this big treasure of Gandhiism and his ideals, and you have actually dissected even untouchability in various ways, or even truth, ahimsa in different ways. So this whole body of knowledge, and as Mr. David has rightly pointed out, even the villagers or even the educated people don't know exactly, haven't understood Gandhi in his full dimensions or in his various dimensions. So what is the hope that we have now, and how can we have at least some part of Gandhi implemented in our society? Like, in so many areas he has touched upon, but some areas, very important areas, where we can implement this. Of course, you have said in the education that this book can be made compulsory in all the schools, and this teachings can be, and that is a, of course, a best way to go ahead, because at least the just next generation will be able to imbibe his ideals and try to implement. But that apart, in the public sphere, what some initiative as we go into the 151st year of Gandhi's birth. Any quick thoughts before we wind?
Just a couple of thoughts. One is that what gives one hope is what gave Gandhi hope. You know, Gandhi in his struggle against the British also, there were many points in his struggle where he, where everything was despair and gloom, and it looked as if we will never get independence. But he had great faith in the ordinary people of the country. And he said that the ordinary people of this country know what is right and what is wrong. They may not know what words to use, but they know instinctively what is right and what is wrong. And so they will definitely be able to make the right decisions. Can you hear me?
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. And I have, I still think that there's a lot of a basis to what Gandhi said. All of us who work with ordinary people know that that what Gandhi said at that time, 100 years back, is still true today. Ordinary people know what is right and what is wrong. So when a thing like the farm bills, for example, comes up, they may not know that what its history is. They may not know what Gandhi said. They may not have heard about Champaran, but they will know that this is something which is not good. And I hope that they will then resist it. So I think that even if Gandhi's thoughts or as a body of knowledge are not widely known, I think the people of this country have a wisdom, and that gives me a lot of hope. As far as people like all of us are concerned, people who are in the field of education or in general thought, what we need to do is simply to spread the knowledge of Gandhi's basic philosophies, basic principles and policies as widely as possible. And to show, just as Mr. Sahu did just now, you know, that it's something that history is repeating itself. People fought against the indigo farmers in Champaran in 1917. Today, in 2020, we are being forced to fight against the contract farmers. And I think it's a wonderful analogy which Sahu used, that it's really a repeat of the Champaran Satyagraha. And many of the problems which we find in the world today, all you can find parallels in Gandhi's writings and teachings. And so we need to publicize that and say that, you know, it was at that time, the same problem was there, it is there today also. So let us hope for the best and let's go forward.
I remember after Champaran Satyagraha, you know, Mahatma Gandhi referred to the Champaran spirit, you know, till India got independence, and even he referred to Champaran spirit in Geneva. He went to England, and in the context of the failure of the League of Nations, you know, he was talking about the Champaran spirit. He said, had there been the spirit of nonviolence guiding League of Nations, that would not have failed. Okay, so in the larger global context, he was invoking Champaran. But he made a very significant point, you know, after independence, when we were facing the horrible consequences of the communal killing following the partition. He said, the kind of non-violence which was displayed in Champaran, independent India would require a very higher form of non-violence. So much higher than the kind of non-violence which was employed, in Champaran. So I believe, this higher form of non-violence, very nicely David put it, it's the hope lies with ordinary people. Because they deep inside them, they understand Gandhi. I mean, not in terms of an intellectual approach, but there is a fascination for Gandhi, there is a tremendous, liking for Gandhi. So, and as Gandhi said after he came back from South Africa, he was asked a question as to how he would fight against the mighty British Empire. And Gandhi's reply was, with the strength of dumb millions. Okay, so he said, with the strength of dumb millions, he would fight against the mighty British Empire. So that means with the very strength of ordinary people, he would confront the challenge. So same thing, I think the higher form of nonviolence which Gandhi said would be required for independent India. I think this time has come for that higher form of nonviolence, but of course, by enlisting the support of the ordinary people. And that it's not an easy job, so somewhere I think the dynamics of our democracy, or maybe dynamics of the present day society, would certainly create conditions where that kind of idea would evolve and emerge. So that is the hope one has.
Yeah. So it's actually very heartening to note that the common man, as both of you pointed out, they have that spirit of Gandhiji in his teachings in them, even though they may not have read about it. So that is reflective in every action, whether the farmers are fighting out now in the streets with all the might they have. So that shows that that Gandhian ideal is still there, but not to the extent that we feel sometimes. But it is the educated people, the policy makers, and a lot of the elite who are being distanced from the Gandhian ideals. So we need to bring that into the lives of everyone, and that is going to be a big challenge. But as both of you said, the hope is that the common man already has it in him. And maybe they should also be taught more in the coming days as we go ahead about his ideals and make them more stronger. Because ultimately our nation has the potential to emerge as a superpower. It was already a superpower long back. That is what we are told. But it was lost over the years due to colonial rule. And now it's the time to recover that glory. And I think Gandhism is the right way to go about it.